Question: have you ever swung as hard and steep as you can to create monster spin, but nothing at all came of it? Did you blame your racket, your strings, yourself? You don't want to admit it, but most likely it was your opponent's fault. Another thing that can happen is that the combined pass of the racket and ball can neutralize each other. Or two, you might simply have come up against the law of maximum spin. Flying, spinning, bouncing tennis balls are wondrous things. The 4 to 5 millisecond impact with the court or strings looks so simple, hardly in need of any explanation, and yet it is incredibly complex when you examine it in millisecond detail. And what you find out can blow your mind. What we find out about spin is a case in point. We all want to bend it, or better, spin it like Beckham, Nadal, Woods, Brady, or Kershaw, whomever, depending on the sport. Spin is ubiquitous in sports. It is much studied, much taught, but little appreciated in its full conceptual wonder, especially by the end users. They just do it. So we have to ask, what really matters when it comes to spinning a tennis ball? This list presents some of the most popular candidates. Most players would probably say yes to most of the items listed, and they would, more or less, be correct. Results from experiments at Tennis Warehouse University would support that conclusion, but with the caveat that all items do not carry equal weight, and often the effect is either unexpected or contrary to assumption. There are also other important influences not listed here. Given those disclaimers, let's check off each item on the list as an influencer. But influencer or not, what we really want to know is, why do they all contribute to spin? How much do they contribute? Can we alter their contributions? And is there a limit to their contributions? Now, not only do we have a long list, we also have lots of questions. What's a poor tennis player to do? Well, first, to help us answer these questions, we'll condense our list into 4 influencer categories. 1, friction and contact velocity. 2, elasticity and snapback. 3, undue events. And 4, facilitating factors. And to make matters easier still, in this tutorial, we will only deal with the first category, friction and contact velocity. Contact velocity refers to how fast the incident ball is moving across the strings due to both its linear and rotational speeds. By across the strings, we mean motion in a direction between 3 and 9 o'clock on the racket face. This motion, in turn, determines how long friction will continue to change spin and what maximum spin can be attained. In effect, contact velocity is the on-off switch for friction. It is also the raw material out of which spin is made. But first, before we see friction and contact velocity in action, we need to establish the context of the discussion. First, the ground rules are no math, just concepts. Second, when talking about spin generation, we are only talking about topspin. And third, I want you to imagine that the string bed looks and behaves more like a flat, solid surface, like a board perhaps. This allows us to see how friction works in its essence, independent of string properties and behavior. It is, after all, this type of friction that gives us 80 to 100% of our spin anyway. We will call this the friction-only phase of the impact, and we will look at the other 20% contributed by categories 2 to 4 in another tutorial. Given that context, we ask, what is friction, and what does friction do? Friction is the force resisting relative motion between two surfaces in contact. It is a grabbiness of sorts, such as you imagine occurring with Velcro or sandpaper. You see friction at work when you roll a ball across the court or when a shot bounces from the court or racket. Let's briefly look at each of these. When a ball rolls, there is very little friction because the speed of the spinning ball at the contact point is equal to, but in the opposite direction of, the ball's forward linear motion. The speeds cancel so that there is no relative motion between the surfaces, and thus almost no friction. The ball will roll a relatively long way before it stops. However, the ball rarely rolls during a bounce, but it does slide. For example, Here we have the ball landing on the court with no spin and sliding before it bites and bounces. When the bottom of the ball bites the surface, it literally sticks to the surface and does not move forward, even though the rest of the ball continues to do so by stretching, twisting, and deforming. While the ball is sliding, friction acts in the opposite direction and slows and spins the ball. When the ball bites, there is no relative motion of the surfaces, so friction stops and there is no increase in spin. Sliding friction is much greater than rolling friction. Static friction is in between, and that is what holds the contact point in place during the biting phase. And the same thing happens when the ball hits the racket. The ball initially slides across the strings, while friction acts to decrease its speed and change its spin. Then the ball bites and friction stops. When the ball bites, maximum spin has been achieved, and for any given impact, this will occur at the exact same spin for every string type, pattern, gauge, material, texture, etc. It may occur earlier or later in the impact, depending on the string, but it will occur at the exact same spin. In fact, if biting occurs earlier, friction may actually reverse direction and reduce the spin already achieved. But that is a topic of another tutorial. For the friction-only phase of the impact, the outgoing spin will depend almost entirely on the magnitude and makeup of the contact velocity, not on the makeup of the string surface. So that being said, let's look more closely at this important parameter of contact velocity. Contact velocity is determined by the ball's incident speed, spin, and angle, and the racket's speed, angle, and tilt. When we mix all these variables together and throw in, behind the scenes of course, a pinch of math, we find that contact velocity is the net relative speed of the incident ball parallel to the strings. The key words here are net relative and parallel. We already discussed what we mean by parallel as the speed across the strings. Net relative involves a process known as changing our frame of reference. When we watch a ball hit a racket while sitting by the side of the court, compared to that observation position, we see the ball and racket traveling at their individual speeds and angles towards each other. We refer to this observation vantage point as the court frame of reference. In other words, all of our measurements will be relative or referenced to our observation location. Instead, what we want to do is see and measure the impact from the racket's point of view. By analogy, when we on Earth, speeding through space, see an asteroid approaching, we say that it is coming at us at such and such a speed. We think of that approach speed as the asteroid speed, even though it is really the combined speed of the two approaching objects. Similarly, the racket sees the ball approaching at the combined speed of the racket and the ball. Okay, now, to change our frame of reference to that of the racket, we draw relative path diagrams. In these diagrams, the length of the arrows correspond to the speed, and the direction of the arrow is the ball's approach angle away from the horizontal. But before we draw an actual relative path diagram, let's look first at the diagramming technique. To diagram a ball's path toward a racket, we would diagram the speed, angle from horizontal, and spin. And to diagram the racket's path, we draw lines and arrows representing its speed, swing angle, and racket head tilt. So with that diagramming technique in hand, let's now draw a relative path. To do so, let's consider the simplified situation of a non-spinning ball approaching from left to right, horizontal to the ground, and the racket, without any tilting, swinging up at an angle to meet the ball. First, we draw the ball path and then the racket path, as we previously learned. From here, it is easy to make ball impact relative to the racket. We simply have to subtract the racket speed from the racket and give it to the ball. And we do that by simply reversing the direction of the racket path arrow. Now we connect the starting point of the ball's path to the impact point on the racket. This is the relative path. We have combined the separate racket and ball paths into a single path onto a now stationary racket. This is simplified because we now have one object traveling one path instead of two objects traveling two paths. This is both easier to visualize and to calculate. If we know the ball and racket speeds and angles, then we can figure out the speed and angle of the relative path. Having done so, we can now hide our original paths and use only the relative path to next determine the contact speed parallel to the strings, which is what we are after in the first place. When a relative path is diagonal to the strings, it is effectively comprising motion in two directions, one perpendicular and the other parallel to the string bed. So to summarize, a diagonal relative path has parallel and perpendicular component paths to the strings. Path lengths are proportional to ball speed. The parallel component is usually slower than the perpendicular one. The perpendicular component determines power, and the parallel component is the linear motion contribution to contact velocity. Going forward, we will call this the linear speed. Knowing the linear contact speed brings us halfway to knowing the total contact velocity. Now we have to calculate and add the spin contact speed to the linear contact speed. To do so, we first want to be able to visualize what it is like to be a spinning ball. For a clockwise spinning ball, the top of the ball is spinning to the right side is spinning downward, the bottom is spinning to the left, and the left side is spinning upward. If the ball were spinning at 1,000 RPM, that would mean that the speed tangential to these four locations is 8 miles per hour in the given directions. If we increase the speed to 2,000 RPM, the tangential speeds would be 16 miles per hour in the indicated directions. So, for a ball spinning in place, every location on the periphery spins at the same tangential speed, and each point on the periphery spins in a different tangential direction. Going forward, we will call this tangential speed at the contact point the spin speed. In order to get the total speed at each of these four locations on the ball, we add the tangential spin speed and the linear speed together. Adding together the spin speed and the linear speed can give interesting and sometimes wildly unexpected contact velocity results. These results will differ depending on whether the relative path is descending, ascending, or perpendicular to the string bed. If the relative path is descending left to right and the ball is spinning clockwise, then both the spin and linear contact speeds will be in the same direction on the strings. Consequently, the contact velocity will be downward and relatively substantial. If the relative path is ascending, then the spin and linear contact speeds will be in opposite directions. As a result, depending on which of the two contact speeds is greater, the net contact velocity may be directed downward, upward, or even perpendicular to the string bed. If the relative path is perpendicular to the string bed and the ball is spinning, then there is no linear ball movement parallel to the string bed, but there is rotational movement. In that case, the contact velocity is composed entirely of the spin speed. If there is no incident spin, then there is no velocity parallel to the strings and all the incident speed is perpendicular. There is one last step that greatly influences contact velocity, and that is the tilt of the racket head. If the ball is descending, tilting the racket forward will increase the linear speed downward across the strings. If the ball is ascending, tilting the racket forward will decrease the linear speed upward across the strings. In both cases, tilting will increase the total change in spin during impact. Now we know what contact velocity is, what its component parts are, and how to determine it. But why is it so important? We said earlier that it was important because it determines how long friction will last. How does it do this? As we have seen, when the ball hits the strings, it begins to slide, and friction acts in the opposite direction to slow the ball and reverse its spin. This process not only depends on the magnitude of the contact velocity, but also on one other very critical parameter, the ratio of the two ingredients of contact velocity. This velocity is called the spin ratio, and it shows how much of the contact velocity is due to linear speed and how much to spin speed. It is defined as the linear contact speed divided by the spin contact speed. This is critical because, in effect, besides simply reversing incoming spin, the hitter is also turning linear motion into rotational motion. The greater the incident linear speed compared to the spin speed, the more the raw material you have to convert. Let's see how this works with the help of the animation. For our friction-only analysis, remember we are ignoring all other spin agents like elastic snapback, unsymmetrical forces, and friction reversal. The spin speed will change about 1.8 times as much as the linear speed. So for every mile per hour that the linear speed is decreased, the spin speed will change 1.8 miles per hour. Usually, because the spin speed is changed at a faster rate, it will decrease to zero and then start increasing in the other direction before the linear speed is reduced to zero. In fact, the spin speed will increase until it is equal to, but opposite in direction, from the remaining linear speed. At this point, the opposite speeds cancel, leaving the contact point with no velocity. At this point, we say the ball bites the strings. Now there is no relative speed between the ball and the strings, so friction stops, and there is no further increase in spin due to friction. So if you begin with a high percentage of linear speed compared to spin speed, then you can turn more linear speed into spin speed before you reach the friction limit for that particular impact. Sometimes the spin ratio characterizing the contact velocity will be greater than 1, indicating more linear speed than spin speed. Other times it will be less than 1, indicating more spin speed than linear speed. Combining the spin ratio with the 1.8 times multiplier, we can get some interesting outgoing spin results. For example, the animation shows two such results. The contact velocity for both is 20 miles per hour, but one has a spin ratio of 3, the green, and the other, the yellow, has a spin ratio of 0.33. The colored bars show the changing speeds and spins throughout the impact as each ball evolves toward the condition of equal and opposite linear and spin speeds. In the top green example, the linear speed simply decreases while the spin and its corresponding spin speed changes direction. In the lower yellow example, because there is so much incident spin speed compared to linear speed, it is the linear speed that changes direction, as the spin speed is simply decreased. As a result, the top green impact rebounds with top spin, and the bottom yellow impact bounces with backspin and reversed linear direction. The impact animations on the right qualitatively show these changes as they occur. Notice that both impacts have the same contact velocity and the same total change in spin, even though the outgoing spins were different. Total change in spin will increase as contact velocity increases. But the actual outgoing spin will also depend on the spin ratio. So at the same contact velocity, the ball with the higher spin ratio will have a greater outgoing spin. And if each ball has the same spin ratio, then the ball with the higher contact velocity will have greater spin. If the balls have different spin ratios and contact velocities, then generally, the ball with the higher product spin ratio times contact velocity will have the greatest spin. The following series of animations demonstrates many possible relative paths and contact velocities that can result from altering the speed and angle of the incident ball and racket pass. It is the comparative speeds and angles that are important. The key to the hitter is for the racket path to be faster and steeper than that of the incoming ball. This will provide more contact velocity to turn into spin, and it can also dial up the spin ratio in the hitter's favor. But as we have seen, sometimes just swinging upward or faster won't result in the spin you expect. The incident ball and racket paths can add to, subtract from, or cancel each other in creating contact velocity. And any outgoing spin created using the contact velocity raw material is limited by the law of maximum spin, which forbids spin speed to exceed linear speed for friction-only conditions. So there you have it. About 80% or more of the change in spin comes from sliding friction, independent of any other factors. And amazingly, string type has very little effect on the maximum spin produced for any given set of impact parameters during the friction-only phase of the impact. The impact parameters are more important than the equipment when looking at spin creation from the friction-only viewpoint. String type is much more important on the remaining 20% of spin, which we will cover in another tutorial. However, what is clear is that the player can do several things to increase spin, even given our friction-only restrictions. The player can take the ball on the descent, increase swing speed and angle, and tilt the racket forward. Increasing contact velocity by any way will increase the hitter's spin. Unfortunately, the spin, speed, and angle of the ball delivered by your opponent often have the greatest say in your spin production. The first player to hit the big spin shot gains advantage in the spin war. The returner has to use up most of his effort and contact velocity, turning spin around instead of making some of his own. But there is hope and help lurking in the other 20% of spin production. We will examine that in another tutorial.